So Dr. Scholz, we have a patient who's trying to choose the best course of action. He didn't list his age, but usually the median, you know, caller that we get in is about 68, between 68 and 72. So they had a clear MRI, clear bone scan. The genomic test came back as high risk, and their first PSA was 4.7, and then it is currently 3.0. The biopsy found two positive cores. One core was 4+4 with 15% involvement, and the other one was 3+4 with 10% involvement. And they'd want to know, should they pursue aggressive treatment? You know, does the 4+4 put them in the high-risk category? What do you think the next steps are?
The Gleason score drives the dialogue as the number one thing. It's more powerful than PSA is. You could argue it's more powerful than percent biopsies and even tumor size. So 4+4 is high risk, and that doesn't really lend itself to any kind of monitoring unless someone's maybe in their 80s, you could watch it. So it's time to treat it, and that opens up a big can of worms. There's so many different options, and could he undergo focal therapy, radiation treatments, some sort of systemic therapy is usually part of the mix. But I'd say the one thing we could say fairly confidently is that it's not active surveillance time unless they're in their 80s.
So our next question is regarding prostate cancer symptoms. Now, we get a lot of questions about this. Obviously, with our YouTube channel and our website, we're encountering a lot of people who are trying to figure out if they have prostate cancer. Maybe they haven't had an official diagnosis. And this person has blood in their urine, and they're wondering, is this a symptom of prostate cancer?
Almost certainly not. One thing that's missing in that analysis is, what is their PSA? My feeling is that if people are checking their PSAs and their PSAs aren't ridiculously out of whack, say over 20 or even much higher than that, symptoms are almost invariably from prostatitis or BPH or infection or some other unrelated cause, not cancer. Cancer is a silent problem, and this is why PSA was so revolutionary when it came out in the late 80s. PSA gave us some insight into what we considered a totally silent illness. So symptoms are a clickbait for people. Prostate cancer symptoms, we're all obviously very protective of our own health, and the thought of cancer is quite frightening, and we listen to our bodies carefully, and especially people that have dealt with cancer in the past. There's, you know, does this ache or pain represent cancer? But PSA has changed that. If people's PSA is in check, which means if it's normal or it's in, say less than 20, is picking the number I used previously, guaranteed. Symptoms are not from prostate cancer, not at such low levels.
So our next question is regarding PSA reading. This person has been on Lupron for 6 months, and they'd like to know, what is a good range for their PSA to be at, since the Lupron seems, is it working or not?
It's a very relevant question. The things that we use to predict how people are going to turn out long-term with prostate cancer, how's the Gleason score, PSA responses, this person's talking about, or we call it PSA nadir. The 6 month time period is very apropos. After a person begins hormone treatment, we expect the PSA to bottom out within about 6 months. And where should it bottom out? Ideally less than 0.1. And in patients who are not seeing their PSA get down to less than 0.1 after 6 months, those individuals may have a more vigorous type of cancer. And further investigation may be necessary to make sure that this is not something a little worse than what was initially thought. Most patients will have their PSA drop to 0.1 within 6 months.
Hey everyone, it's me and Sir Hunter the Dowel, our PCRI mascot. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Hunter definitely wants you to. And if he can high-five me, you have to subscribe right now. Oh, you're already high-fiving me. Good job. Thanks so much. Visit our YouTube channel and also our website for more information at pcri.org. Say bye.